All right, last week we started talking about light and darkness. How Jesus is the light of the world, that light, the light is used as a metaphor constantly in Scripture of truth, of just who God is. God himself says he is light and that he is going to be our light. We talked about how darkness actually doesn't exist. It's a figment of our imagination in the sense that you cannot measure darkness. Darkness is actually not real. Darkness is just the way we refer to light's absence. Of course, we also said the same thing about cold, right? And last week, it was hard to imagine that cold wasn't real because it was cold. But really, it's heat. Either heat exists or heat doesn't exist. Cold is just the word we use to describe when heat is lacking. Dark is the word we use to describe when light isn't there. But we said last week, all light actually has to do to defeat darkness is show up. Darkness can't stand in front of the light. Darkness can't exist where light is. But this morning, I want to talk about darkness a little bit more. We talked about the light last week, how God is light, how he calls us to be a reflection of his light. And his light is truth and love and justice and mercy. But what about darkness? How many of us have heard of the Prince of Darkness? Heard of the Prince of Darkness? You know, that phrase actually isn't found in the Bible. You can search Genesis to Revelation. You're not going to find the phrase Prince of Darkness. Like so many things concerning the devil, this particular thing came from Milton's classic poem, Paradise Lost. This is how Milton refers to Satan. Now, Satan is an agent of darkness. So what does that mean? If darkness doesn't exist, how can Satan be on the side of darkness? How can Satan be the prince of darkness if there is no such thing as darkness? You're thinking, man, Kenneth, you were talking crazy this morning. Well, if darkness is just the absence of light, that tells us exactly what Satan's role is. His role is to hide God's light. That's what he tries to do. Actually, Paul warns us that this is Satan's job. In Ephesians chapter 6, starting in verse 12, or just verse 12, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly realms." He's talking about Satan. And Satan's number one tool, Satan's number one job, what he tries to do to us, is hide the light. He wants to cast a shadow. He wants to keep us from seeing what God is trying to show us. And Satan is good at this. Don't ever think Satan can't do what he sets out to do. Satan is the great deceiver, the father of all lies, is what Jesus calls him. But I want to take a minute this morning. I want us to think, how does Satan keep us in the dark? If the light is God's truth, if the light is God's love, if the light is God's mercy, and who wouldn't want those things, really? If somebody said, I want to give you love and mercy and forgiveness, who would say, no, I'm sorry, don't want that? Anybody? Please don't raise your hand. You wouldn't, would you? That's something everybody would want. So how in the world, if the creator of the universe is offering such wonderful things, how does Satan get us to say no so often? I'll give you three things this morning. Three things that Satan uses to hide the light from us. The problem is, we're the ones who set him up to be able to do this. Pleasure, entitlement, and pride. But there's another way I could say this. John chapter, or 1 John, there should be a one there. 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. I thought that sounded too churchy, so I redid it. Pleasure, entitlement, pride. Using these three things that unfortunately exist within us, the desire for pleasure, the sense of entitlement, and our pride, Satan has a heyday keeping us in the dark. So let's look at those, just each one in its turn. First is pleasure. Who does not like pleasure? And if you raise your hand and say, I don't like pleasure, I'm going to ask you, do you like chocolate? Answer's probably yes, right? Or last week it was tamales. I'm still a little full from that meal. We like pleasure, right? We like to feel good. Everybody wants to feel good. But here's where pleasure turns against us sometimes. Sometimes we make pleasure the end goal. Sometimes we think feeling good is what life is all about. Or more than that, we think pleasure can cancel pain. Let me say that again. We think pleasure can cancel pain. Have you ever wondered how somebody, you may know this personally, but if you don't, have you ever wondered how somebody can get caught in substance abuse? Actually, get caught up in any kind of addiction. There's all kinds of addictions out there. Talk to any counselor, they'll tell you. But the basis for all addictions tends to be exactly the same thing. An attempt to escape pain by finding pleasure in something else. And we try, and we try, and we try, and it never works. Why do most people take drinking to extreme? They just want to feel good, right? Does it ever work? For a brief moment, maybe. But then there's a bigger toll to pay on the backside. When I lived in Kentucky, I think I've said this story before, but hey, there's new people here. I can tell my stories again, right? We had a serious problem in Muhlenberg County, Kentucky, right in the middle of the state, coal mining country. We were about as rural as you could get. But our problem was we were one of the top meth-producing areas in the entire United States. It was so bad that we couldn't even take our teens out to pick up trash on the side of the road for fear one of the bottles they would pick up would be filled with anhydrous ammonia, what they would use to cut the drugs to make the meth. And it wasn't an unfounded fear. It happened all the time. Now, the thing I learned, that they put together a task force that I was asked to be on for a little while about trying to educate people, trying to help people realize how bad methamphetamines are. You know what the real trick with methamphetamines is? Your first hit will give you the highest high you've ever felt. And you will sacrifice your life to get it again, and you never will. It's one of those drugs that, you know, you always hear people say, kids, you've heard your teachers say, you know, you could be addicted in just one hit. Meth is one of the key drugs that's almost always that way. People try to escape their pain, they go looking for pleasure, but in the end, all they find is pain. Because the pleasure doesn't actually fix the problem. You know, we desire pleasure because, hey, it feels good. It makes us feel good in the moment, but sometimes we're feeling pain for a reason. What happens when you cover up symptoms? If you're sick and you take something that just covers up your symptoms, are you actually going to get better? No, if something's causing you pain and you just take pain pills and the pills numb the pain for a little while, what happens when the pills wear off? The pain is back because you haven't actually treated the problem. Pleasure is the ultimate pain pill that only lasts for a moment. And we as humans spend way too much time chasing after pleasure when maybe we should be addressing whatever's causing the pain. And this is where Satan has so much of a more easy time than God. Because God says, look at your pain, address your pain, and I help you find relief on the other side. Satan says, oh, I got an easier way. Pop this pill, do this thing, whatever. And I'll take away your pain right now. And people believe Satan because it's easier, it's faster, it takes so little effort on our part. But yet in the end, we're worse off. We've chased pleasure, and all we find is more pain. But pleasure is just the first. The second, entitlement. I deserve more. You ever seen this attitude? Anybody ever come across this? Are you alive? Yeah, you've come across it. It runs rampant in our society right now. Everybody thinks they deserve everything. I deserve whatever it is I think I want. Now, this is such a different attitude than what you would have found just 50, 100 years ago in our society. 50 years ago, 100 years ago in our society, you didn't deserve anything. Whatever you were going to get, you were going to have to work hard for. You were going to have to bust your tail. You were going to have to give it everything you got. And even then, you still may not get the thing you're wanting. But hey, back then, that was life. You just acknowledge that's the way the world works. But it's so easy to develop the attitude, I deserve the things I want. I deserve to have whatever, because I'm special. I remember reading an article, and this was years ago, but the guy could tell the way things were going, I suppose. He was talking about college freshmen coming into the universities, saying how this was, in his time in university, this group of freshmen felt the absolute best about themselves of any group he had ever taught. And yet they accomplished absolutely nothing. Because they were raised on a diet of, you're special. You're awesome. You're better than everybody else. No, you can't hit a free throw, but man, you're better than LeBron James. We actually live in a society that promotes this sense of entitlement. I'm special, therefore I deserve. Now again, Satan has a field day here where what God sells is a little harder. Because God says, no, what you deserve, you don't want. Because you deserve punishment. You deserve destruction. Your sin deserves death. That's what we've earned. That's what we've managed to get for ourselves. Left to what we deserve, we don't deserve much. Yet God freely gives mercy and love and justice and hope. Not because we deserve it. He's very clear about that. We didn't earn a bit of it. He gave it simply because he loves us. Satan, on the other hand, looks at you and says, man, just look in the mirror. You know you're special. You know you deserve whatever it is you think you want. You know you deserve to have everything you want without working a day in the world for it, right? Am I just making this up? Or can you see this in the world around you? Can you see it in yourself sometimes? Because Satan tells this lie so well. He gets us so caught up in ourselves, we start to believe him. Which brings me to the third one. Pride. My accomplishments make me who I am. Look at what I've done. Look at what I've achieved. Look at how special I am. As if anything we could do hasn't already been done 1,000 times before. 4,000 years ago, 3,000 years ago, I don't know, I get my dates mixed up. Solomon, king of Israel, wisest man to ever live, richest man to ever live, one of the most powerful men to ever live, looked at his life and said, what a waste of time. Everything I've done has been done before and will be done again. There's absolutely nothing new under the sun. And whatever I accomplished, Solomon said, man, somebody else is just going to tear down anyway. His wisdom came to his rescue in that particular circumstance. He realized what he accomplished wasn't what mattered. And at the end of the book of Ecclesiastes, he wrote, so what matters most? Fear God, keep his commandments. That's what actually matters. It's in serving God. It's in serving the light. It's in reflecting God's love and joy and mercy and righteousness that we actually find our purpose. If we're finding our purpose other places, that purpose is going to let us down. And I don't care what it is. You could be the greatest business person of the modern age. Somebody else will pass you eventually. You could be the greatest athlete of the modern age. Somebody's going to pass you rather soon. I still argue Michael Jordan beats LeBron James hands down. Nobody under the age of 30 agrees with me. Because there's always somebody bigger. There's always somebody better. There's always something else coming. Even in our lives, because, you know, I'm not going to beat LeBron or Michael or anybody remotely resembling. Just in our small town, I gain influence. I become somebody. I'm on this committee. I'm on this board. I do this. I do that. All those things. All good things. Nothing wrong with any of them. But if that's where you find your purpose, what will all that be worth 50 years from now? The answer is not much. You see, when we start taking pride in what we have done, we lose sight of what God has done. And everything good in our life was Him, not us. Every good thing comes from Him. Every one of those great moments was only there because God allowed it to be there. Every one of those accomplishments I only accomplished because God gave me the strength, He gave me the ability, He gave me the skills, He gave me the opportunity to try. Without Him, nothing. But Satan wants to obscure that. So through our pride, through our sense of entitlement, through our search for pleasure, he causes us to block the light. We become the shadow that we can't see through. To help illustrate this, turn your Bibles over to Luke chapter 15. If you got your Bible, turn over to Luke chapter 15. And we're going to see a story of a young man who, because of his selfishness, his entitlement, and his pride, well, he chased pleasure. He chased prestige. He chased those things that Satan says will fulfill us. And let's see where it led him to. So in Luke chapter 15, starting in verse 11, Jesus begins this story. There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, "Father, give me my share of the estate." So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all that he had and set off for a distant country. And there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that country. And he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country who sent him to feed his pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods the pigs were eating. But no one gave him anything. Now when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's servants have food to spare? And here I stand starving to death. I'll set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against you.'" Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants." So he got up and he went to his father. But while he was still a long ways off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him and ran to his son and threw his arms around him and kissed him. The son said to him, "Father, I've sinned against heaven and I've sinned against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." But the father said to his servants, "Quick, bring the best robe, put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fatted calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For the son of mine who was dead is alive again. He was lost and now is found." So they began to celebrate. I love the end of the story, but let's back up to the first. To put it into context, to help you see what's going on behind the scenes here, what this young man said to his father was, "Dad, you're not dying fast enough." Because he had no right to his inheritance. to his portion of the estate until his father passed. And as long as his father was living, everything actually belonged to the father. Now, the children can claim ownership of it in the sense that, yeah, once their father's passed, it went to them. The oldest son would receive 2/3 of the estate. The younger son would receive 1/3. That's just how inheritance worked in that day and age. So imagine this younger son coming up to his father and saying, "Father, I really wish you were dead because I want this stuff. I deserve this stuff. I need this stuff." Now, if you were the father, how would you have responded? "This father's better than me." Because he said, "Okay. If that's what you really want, here. I'll give you what you shouldn't get. I'll give you what you weren't supposed to get until I'm gone." And the younger son takes it, and he hits the road. And he enjoys pleasure, and he enjoys material items, and he enjoys, for a brief time, being somebody wherever it was he ended up. Because, you know, if you show up with money, somehow you're somebody. Have you noticed how that works? But did it last? He spent, it was gone. Money works that way, if you haven't figured that out. And he ended up far worse than where he started, didn't he? He got everything he wanted, and what did it do for him? Left him in a miserable state. Sometimes we have to be mature enough as humans, as Christians, as people to say, you know, I may not need the things I want. I've told y'all before, when I was a kid, there was one prayer I prayed a lot. I wanted a car. And a Lamborghini really seemed to fit the bill. God never answered that prayer. My first car was an Oldsmobile. About as un-Lamborghini as you can get. You know what? I'm pretty sure the Oldsmobile served me a lot better than the Lamborghini would have. And now that my sons are old enough to drive and I pay their insurance, yeah, I understand a whole lot better. We don't always need the things we want. The things we crave are often the things that are worse for us. Tracy makes a big cheesecake at Christmas. Thick, delicious. It's what I want. It's not always what's best for me. Isn't it funny how often life works that way? But isn't it great we have a God that when we give in to the darkness, when we get lost in the shadows, when we've let our pleasure and our sense of entitlement and our pride lead us right down the wrong path, once we come to our senses, he's still there waiting. He's not holding a grudge. He's not upset. In fact, he's mourning the loss of his child, just like the father in this story was. When the son came home, the father wasn't, "Man, you wasted a third of my estate." No, he said, "Let's throw a party. My son was dead, but now he's alive. My son was lost, but now he's found. Who cares about the other stuff?" Because God knows the other stuff just doesn't matter. Here's the thing about darkness. If you don't take anything else away from this sermon, please just remember this one point. The darkness is all about me. What's the greatest source of darkness in our lives? We are, because we get so caught up in ourselves. We start to worship ourselves. We start to make ourselves the center of our universe. In fact, I'm sure for some people in the world, if they can hear me this morning, they're thinking, "He's talking crazy. Of course I'm the center of my universe." That's darkness. You'll never find peace and true happiness and true joy if you're the center of your own universe. Because you're not strong enough to give that to yourself. But Jesus is the center of the light. Actually, Paul explains this very well. Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 to 14. "But whatever were gained to me..." Now, this is Paul. This is a man who, as a young man, he was on a rocket ship. He was the up and comer. He was the who's who among Jewish leaders. As a young man, he'd gone to the Jewish equivalent of Harvard. He was advancing well beyond all the other men of his age. He was going to be a leader. He was going to be somebody. And then he met Jesus. And this is Paul looking back on everything he thought he had. And this is what he said. But whatever were gained to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything of loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things, and consider them garbage. Let me retranslate. He didn't say garbage. He said something that doesn't translate well into English. He said sewage. Everything he thought he had, his success, his pride, his education, his everything he had in life to that point, he said, compared to knowing Jesus, man, it's sewage to go down the drain. Because nothing compares to knowing Jesus. That I may gain Christ, he considers them all garbage, sewage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law. This isn't about me. This isn't about how good I am. But that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. So here's the summary. I want to know Christ. To know the power of his resurrection. And the participation and participate in his sufferings. Becoming like him in his death. So that somehow attaining the resurrection of the dead. Not that I've already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I don't consider myself to have as of yet taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind, I press on towards the goal to win. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward. In Christ Jesus. Now notice even at the end here, he says, I give it all up, and I still don't have the ultimate prize. I'm still working on that. I'm still living. I'm still working. I'm still growing. I'm still messing up, if I'm going to be honest. But because I'm following the light in Jesus, I have something awesome I'm looking forward to. See, if the darkness is all about us, then the light is all about Jesus. Don't let Satan hide Jesus from your life by convincing you to focus on you. And it's so easy for him to do. Let me use one example. And as a preamble to this example, let me tell you, I have not looked at attendance for small groups in a few weeks. So I don't know who I'm talking to. So if you feel guilty, that one's on you. All right? But I've done small groups enough. I know when you hit the midpoint, we're reaching the mid-year point here, they tend to slump. Why? We get busy, right? Things are going on. Stuff's happening. There are not enough hours in the day. So I have to make priority decisions. What's more important? And the easy answer is always me. My stuff. What I want to do. What I think I need to do. And just giving an hour starts to become a burden. Now, to put this into context, guess what small groups last? I mean, they're supposed to last an hour. Sometimes some of us may get long-winded. They go a little longer. Apply this to, if you're not in small groups, apply this to Wednesday night. Apply this to any other opportunity to serve. Man, I just don't have time to give another hour. You know how busy my schedule is? And then let me ask you this question. Especially if, say, you're 40 and under. How many YouTube videos you watch this week? How many cats have you seen playing pianos? How many sitcoms have you watched? How many video games have you played? If you're just talking an hour, How many hours have you given to things, all of which I like, by the way. I love cats playing pianos. It's fun to watch. I like video games. I'm of that generation, man. I grew up with an Atari. It was awesome. But is it the most important thing in my life? Is it really that hard to say, hey, I'm going to give an hour back to God? More than that, I'm going to give an hour to serve God's people. You know why it's important that you be here Sundays? It's not because God's taken roll. It's because God has a job for you to do. And the job is to build up the people around you, to be a servant to the people sitting around you, so that if it's just even a smile and a handshake and a hug, you've done something to strengthen them. Because the point is to take the focus off of you and put it somewhere else. Small groups work the same way, except even more powerfully so. Because then you start living together week to week, really getting to know each other. And man, you really get to know each other. But then you start holding each other accountable. You start depending on each other. You start motivating each other. It's what friends are for, right? It's what family's for. And guess what we are? Family and friends. Friends of God, adopted children within his family. If the light is about Jesus, it can't be about you. Satan will always use what you want as a means to bring darkness back into your life. You have to fight him. You have to let Jesus take control. Now, the irony in all of it, the things you think you want, easiest way to get them, give them all to God. He'll help you find what you really need. Maybe it is the thing you want. Maybe it's something else. You follow him, you'll find out. You do it yourself, you're going to be disappointed. And there's no way around it. If you're here this morning and you're looking at your own life and you're thinking, you know what? I feel like I'm in darkness, not light. I feel like nothing ever really quite ever works out. I feel like all I do is struggle and nothing ever helps. Well, maybe you've been looking in the wrong place. Because there is light out there. There is grace. There is mercy. There is love. There is hope. But you have to be willing to pursue it. You have to be willing, at least, to accept it.